Hello, hello, it's me, Kenny Polcari, your host of the party, and today is Wednesday, December 8th, 2021. What is it that you need to know? Well, there is breaking news this morning as the sun rises over the Atlantic. Pfizer coming out and saying that their booster shot is enough to neutralize the Omni variant, so there's no need to develop a whole new vaccine. U.S. futures, which were down, have now gone positive. So think there's no oil demand destruction. There's no slowdown in the economy reopening. None of that stuff. It's all off the table. So stocks continued to push higher yesterday in the year end as the fear subsides. And they're even higher again this morning. Oil up again. U.S. futures up again. Santa is alive and well. Big crypto hearing today in D.C. What will we learn or what will they say? And in continuation, Feast of the Seven Fishes. Today it's recipe number 6, baked and broiled salmon. Simple to make and so great. So the march higher continues. Stocks advance. Omicron fears subside. Treasury yields rise. Oil continues to advance. The dollar index holding steady. The VIX, which is the fear index, retreating. As Bitcoin and Ethereum, along with a range of other cryptocurrencies, has calmed down since the drama over the weekend. The House has now sent the bill to the Senate to make sure that they can raise the debt ceiling by next week, which, by the way, means absolutely nothing for stocks at all, because there's no possibility that the clowns in D.C. won't raise the ceiling. All it is drama and theatrics. So do not let that sidetrack your investment thesis. In the end, what the market is telling you is really two things, right? Either inflation is a risk, and if so, all the chatter around a swifter taper and rising rates will deal with that. Market's taking that as a good thing. Or inflation is not a risk. And if the economy begins to slow down due to the swifter taper, then the Fed will slow down the taper and interest rate talks, and that will further support stocks. So it's a win-win. Stocks can't lose, and stocks move higher. At the end of the day, the Dow added another 500 points. This on top of the nearly 700 points on Monday. The S&P gained 95 points or 2%. The NASDAQ, far and away the biggest winner, rising 461 points or better than 3%. The Russell added 50 points, 2.3%, and the transports added just 28 points or 0.2%. But remember, the transports have been adding even as the broader market was weaker. And while all that sounds pretty, I remain a bit more cautious. My sense is that monetary policy for 2022 is going to get more aggressive, and that's going to slow the market's advance. While the Fed has done a good job of telegraphing what they're thinking, we know that it could all change very quickly. I mean, look how fast the narrative changed from we're going to take it slow and taper and rates are not connected. One doesn't mean the other's going to happen. To now, we're doubling the pace of the taper and rates could rise in tandem. So much for we've got it under control, right? That just sends a whole different message. Fed fund futures this morning is now pricing in 3 rate hikes in 22. May, July, and now November-ish, right? Recall it was only 3 months ago when the Fed told us that we might get just 1 rate hike in 2022. And now it's 3. And after 3 is 4, right? Capiche? Again, that does not mean that you need to panic at all. It just means you make sure you understand the risks and plan accordingly. And of course, that also depends on where you are on the risk scale and the age scale. 20 to 50-year-olds should be on the right side of that scale, right? All stocks, maybe no bonds, absolutely no bonds if you're a 20, 30-year-old. Very little bonds, maybe if you're in your 40s or 50s. 50 to 70-year-olds need to be a bit more conscious of what their portfolio looks like and move a bit to the left, becoming slightly more defensive. And the plus 70 group needs to be moving a bit more to the left off the high end of the risk scale as they prepare for their next trip. Again, every sector yesterday was in the green. Tech taking the lead. The XLK up a stunning 3.5%, which makes sense, right? That group is the one that has gotten slammed. The ETF, which has fallen 6.5% over the last month or so, while individual names have fallen so much more. So now, if the sense is that the Fed is doing the right thing and that the economy is strong enough to withstand a swifter taper and 2 or 3 rate increases, then there are a lot of companies that are on sale, and that was clear yesterday. Anything tech was on fire. ARK, right? The Cathie Wood Disruptive ETF, which was absolutely gotten beaten up, down 29% since early November, is now up 13% in 2 days and likely to go higher as investors reassess the outlook. I imagine it's going to hit resistance at $110 a share, which is up another 10% from here before you really have to worry about it. Consumer discretionary XLY taking the lead, rising 2.3%. That speaks directly to the sentiment, right? Because that sector is about discretionary spending, not necessary spending. Necessary spending is consumer staples, the XLP, and that only rose by 0.2%. And to further make that point, the retail ETF, which is the XRT, also rose by 2.2%, right? The XRT and the consumer discretionary go hand in hand. Energy, XLE, was strong again, rising 2.3%. And that ETF, like oil, is now up 8.5% since the panic created 2 weeks ago when they unloaded the Omicron variant on us on the Friday after Thanksgiving, when markets were in an abbreviated session and many participants were away from their desks, allowing the algos to run wild. And run wild they did, fed by the hysteria created by some in the mainstream media, the CDC, and Moderna CEO Stefan Bancel, who told us that the current vaccine may not protect us and that we need to do more. Oh boy, was he talking his book. Moderna stock, which surged on that news, and then it didn't. And now Omicron has been moved to the back burner, the back pages of any legitimate newspaper, because it's not the disaster it initially was made out to be. And the next mutation won't be either, and the mutation after that. So everyone's just got to calm down a bit. Financials, the XLF gained 1.8%, basic materials, XLB up 1.5%, real estate, XLRE up 1.7%, industrials up 1%, even utilities did better than consumer staples, rising by 0.8%. Healthcare, the XLV gaining 1.3%, the value trade, SPYV, up 1.3%, while the growth trade, SPYG, rose a stunning 2.7%. Again, that makes sense. This morning, we're seeing European markets a bit weaker, but with the latest Pfizer news, let's just see if that tone changes. There's no economic data out of Europe today, but Germany does have a new chancellor. So we bid farewell to Angie and wish her continued good health in her twilight years. At 7 a.m., markets across the region remain a bit weaker, down by about 0.5% across the board. Here in the United States, U.S. futures, which were weaker as the sun was rising over the Atlantic, are now solidly higher after the Pfizer news, right? The Dow up 140, S&P's up 21, the NASDAQ up 70, the Russell up 15 points. The Pfizer news is now consuming the headlines. The original two shots plus the booster are enough to neutralize the variant. That's all you need to know, and that is good news. And while it may spread faster and be more transmissible, it is not more dangerous, period. So let's just go back to the fundamentals of the market when you're talking about investing. EcoData today includes mortgage apps, which rose by 2%. That was after last month's decline of 7.2%. And the JOLTS report, job opening and labor turnover survey, and that's expected to show 10.4 million jobs available. But the whisper number is for 10.6 million jobs. That report hits the tape at 10 a.m., so make sure you're watching what happens to futures right around 10 o'clock or right before 10 o'clock to see really who knew what the report was going to say. 10-year treasuries are yielding 1.46%, just a bit weaker, but I would expect that's going to turn around now as the sun moves across the sky and investors take in this latest Pfizer news. Oil continues to surge and is now up another 70 cents at $72.70 a barrel. This after that Pfizer news hit the tape. And why? Because Omni will not destroy demand the way the mainstream media led you to believe. And it's off. Like I said last week to a Twitter follower who told me that I was wrong when I told him that we were going to see oil at 80 before 60. Well, we're now 7 points away from my target and 12 points away from his. Because he was much more concerned about what Omni was going to do. And I kept telling him I didn't think it was an issue. The S&P closed at 4686. And with all the excitement this morning, expect us to pierce 4700 again by the opening. So the all-time high of 4743 once again appears to be within grasp. Amazing, really, right? But remember, the market can remain illogical longer than you can remain solvent. So don't fight. Go with the trend, but build yourself in some downside protection, especially as we move higher and higher, because again, we all know how quickly the narrative can change. Brett does remain a bit questionable with more stocks below their 200-day versus above their 200-day. So that's just something to think about when you're thinking about, you know, out 2 months, 3 months, 4 months out, right? Remember, you can text the word invest to 21,000 on your cell phone to get my digital business card. Feel free to download it, send me off an email or text, give me a call. I'm always happy to engage, talk markets, planning, thoughts, concerns, and ideas. You can follow me on Twitter and TikTok at Kenny Polcari and on Instagram at KennyP1961. Okay, so here we go. We're continuing with the Feast of the Seven Fishes. We're on recipe number 6. All for the Christmas Eve dinner, right? Where we feature in an Italian household 7 different kinds of fish, all buffet style, so it's all laid out, right? So this one is baked broiled salmon. It's simple to make, simple, but when you're trying to put all that food out, this just makes it easier, right? You'll need a couple of things. You need the salmon. You can cut them into individual portions if you want. It's easier. Old Bay seasoning and some fresh lemon juice. It's all you need, right? Get your salmon skin on, rinse it under cold water, pat it dry with some paper towels, place it nicely in the baking dish, however many you're going to have. You know, in my house, we have about 20 pieces all the time. Season it with Old Bay, a squirt of fresh lemon juice, and put it in the oven, right? Turn your oven on, bake 375 degrees, put it in the oven for 10 to 15 minutes, again, depending on how thick it is, then turn it from bake to broil. Don't put it right up against the heat, but put it kind of in that middle rack and let the tops get nice and a little bit crispy brown, right? The Old Bay will get a little bit crispy. It's really, really good. You don't want to burn it, but you want it to have just a little bit of a kind of goldeny tone on top of that beautiful pink that the salmon is. In any event, just take it out when it's done. Present it out on a nice, you know, white platter, or you put a white platter, maybe you put kale down and put the fish on top of that because it presents beautifully. And it actually looks kind of Christmassy, right? Because the salmon is kind of a pinky orange, and then you got the green and you got the white, you got all the other food around it, and you got the Christmas tree and all the ornaments. And so it all feels very Christmassy. In any event, look, the sun is up. I had to pull my shade down today because the light was so bright coming in. It's going to be a gorgeous day here in South Florida. So take good care until tomorrow.